Chapter number 5, States of Matter. Introduction. In previous units, we have learned about the properties related to single particle of matter, such as atomic size, ionization enthalpy, electronic charge density, molecular shape and polarity, etc. Most of the observable characteristics of chemical system with which we are familiar represent bulk properties of matter. That is, the properties associated with a collection of a large number of atoms, ions or molecules. For example, an individual molecule of a liquid does not boil, but the bulb boils. Collection of water molecules have wetting properties. Individual molecules do not wet. Water can exist as ice, which is a solid. It can exist as liquid, or it can exist in the gaseous state as water vapor or steam. Physical properties of ice, water and steam are very different. In all the three states of water, chemical composition of water remains the same. That is H2O. Characteristics of the three states of water depend on the energies of molecules and on the manner in which water molecules aggregate. Same is true for the other substances also. Chemical properties of a substance do not change with the change of its physical state, but rate of chemical reactions do depend upon the physical state. Many times in calculations, while dealing with data of experiments, we require knowledge of the state of matter. Therefore, it becomes necessary for a chemist to know the physical laws which govern the behavior of matter in different states. In this unit, we will learn more about these three physical states of matter, particularly liquid and gaseous states. To begin with, it is necessary to understand the nature of intermolecular forces, molecular interactions, and effect of thermal energy on the motion of particles, because a balance between this determines the state of a substance. 5.1 Intermolecular forces. Intermolecular forces are the forces of attraction and repulsion between interacting particles. This term does not include the electrostatic forces that exist between the two oppositely charged ions and the forces that hold atoms of a molecule together, that is, covalent bonds. Attractive intermolecular forces are known as van der Waals forces in honor of Dutch scientist John van der Waals, who explained the deviation of real gases from the ideal behavior through these forces. We will learn about this later in this unit. Van der Waals force vary considerably in magnitude and include dispersion forces or London forces, dipole-dipole forces and dipole-induced dipole forces. A particularly strong type of dipole-dipole interaction is hydrogen bonding. Only a few elements can participate in hydrogen bond formation, therefore it is treated as a separate category. We have already learned about this interaction in Unit 4. At this point, it is important to note that attractive forces between an ion and a dipole are known as ion-dipole forces, and these are not van der Waals forces. We will now learn about different types of van der Waals forces. 5.1.1 Dispersion forces or London forces. Atoms and nonpolar molecules are electrically symmetrical and have no dipole moment because their electronic charge cloud is symmetrically distributed. But a dipole may develop momentarily even in such atoms and molecules. This can be understood as follows. Suppose we have two atoms, A and B, in the close vicinity of each other. Figure 5.1.A. It may so happen that momentarily, electronic charge distribution in one of the atoms, say A, becomes unsymmetrical. That is, the charge cloud is more on one side than the other. This results in the development of instantaneous dipole on the atom A for a very short time. This instantaneous or transient dipole distorts the electron density of the other atom B, which is close to it, and as a consequence, a dipole is induced in the atom B. The temporary dipoles of atom A and B attract each other. Similarly, temporary dipoles are induced in molecules also. This force of attraction was first proposed by the German physicist Fritz London, and for this reason, force of attraction between two temporary dipoles is known as London force. Another name for this force is dispersion force. These forces are always attractive and interaction energy is inversely proportional to the sixth power of the distance between two interacting particles. These forces are important only at short distances, and their magnitude depends on the polarizability of the particle. 5.1.2 Dipole-dipole forces. Dipole-dipole forces act between the molecules possessing permanent dipole. Ends of the dipole possess partial charges, and these charges are shown by Greek letter delta. Partial charges are always less than the unit electronic charge. The polar molecules interact with neighboring molecules. Figure 5.2a shows electron cloud distribution in the dipole of hydrogen chloride, and figure 5.2b shows dipole-dipole interaction between two hydrochloride molecules. This interaction is strong than the London forces but is weaker than ion-ion interaction because only partial charges are involved. The attractive forces decreases with the increase as of distance between the dipoles. As in the above case, here also the interaction energy is inversely proportional to distance between polar molecules. Dipole-dipole interaction energy between stationary polar molecule is proportional to 1 upon r cube, and that between rotating polar molecule is proportional to 1 upon r is to 6, where r is the distance between polar molecules. Besides dipole-dipole interaction, polar molecules can interact by London forces also. Thus, cumulative effect is that the total of intermolecular forces in polar molecule increases. 5.1.3 Dipole-induced dipole forces. This type of attractive forces operate between the polar molecules having permanent dipole and the molecule lacking permanent dipole. Permanent dipole of the polar molecule induces dipole on the electrically neutral molecule by deforming its electronic cloud. Thus, an induced dipole is developed in the other molecule. In this case also, interaction energy is proportional to 1 upon r is to 6, where r is the distance between two molecules. Induced dipole moment depends upon the dipole moment present in the permanent dipole and the polarizability of the electrically neutral molecule. We have already learned in unit 4 that molecules of larger size can be easily polarized. High polarizability increases the strength of attractive interactions. In this case also, cumulative effect of dispersion forces and dipole-induced dipole interaction exist. 5.1.4 Hydrogen bond. As already mentioned in section 5.1, this is a special case of dipole-dipole interaction. We have already learned about this in unit 4. This is found in the molecules in which highly polar NH, OH or HF bonds are present. Although hydrogen bonding is regarded as being limited to nitrogen, oxygen and fluorine, but species such as chlorine may also participate in hydrogen bonding. Energy of hydrogen bond varies between 10 to 100 kilojoule per mole. This is quite a significant amount of energy. Therefore, hydrogen bonds are powerful force in determining the structure and properties of many compounds, for example, proteins and nucleic acids. Strength of the hydrogen bond is determined by the Coulombic interaction between the lone pair electrons of the electronegative atom of the one molecule and the hydrogen atom of the other molecule. Following diagram shows the formation of hydrogen bond. Intermolecular forces discussed so far are all attractive. Molecules also exert repulsive forces on one another. When two molecules are brought into close contact with each other, the repulsion between the electron clouds and that between the nuclei of two molecules comes into play. Magnitude of the repulsion rises very rapidly as the distance separating the molecule decreases. This is the reason that liquids and solids are hard to compress. In this state, molecules are already in close contact, therefore they resist further compression, as that would result in the increase or repulsive interactions. 5.2 Thermal energy. Thermal energy is the energy of a body arising from motion of its atoms or molecules. It is directly proportional to the temperature of the substance. It is the measure of average kinetic energy of the particles of the matter and is thus responsible for movement of particles. This movement of particles is called thermal motion. 5.3 Intermolecular forces versus thermal interactions. We have already learned that intermolecular forces tend to keep the molecules together, but thermal energy of the molecules tends to keep them apart. three states of matter are the result of balance between intermolecular forces and the thermal energy of the molecules. When molecular interactions are very weak, molecules do not cling together to make liquid or solid unless thermal energy is reduced by lowering the temperature. Gases do not liquefy on compression only, all the molecules come very close to each other and intermolecular forces operate to the maximum. However, when thermal energy of the molecule is reduced by lowering the temperature, the gases can be very easily liquefied. Predominance of thermal energy and the molecular interaction energy of a substance in three states is depicted as follows. We have already learned the cause for the existence of the three states of matter. Now we will learn more about gases and liquid states and the laws which govern the behavior of matter in the states. We shall deal with the solid state in class 12. 5.4 The gaseous state. This is the simplest states of matter. Throughout our life, we remain immersed in the ocean of air, which is a mixture of gases. We spend our life in the lowermost layer of the atmosphere called troposphere, which is held to the surface of the earth by gravitational force. The thin layer of atmosphere is vital to our life. It shields us from harmful radiations and contains substances like dioxygen, dinitrogen, carbon dioxide, water vapor, etc. Let us now focus our attention on the behavior of substances which exist in the gaseous state under normal conditions of temperature and pressure. A look at the periodic table shows that only 11 elements, the gaseous state is element, only 11 elements exist as a gaseous under normal conditions. The gaseous state is characterized by the following physical properties. Gases are highly compressible. Gases exert pressure equally in all directions. Gases have much lower density than the solids and liquids. The volume and the shape of gases are not fixed. This assumes volume and shape of the container. Gases mix evenly and completely in all proportions without any mechanical aid. Simplicity of gases is due to the fact that the forces of interaction between their molecules are negligible. Their behavior is governed by same general laws which were discovered as a result of their experimental studies. These laws are relationship between measurable properties of gases. Some of these properties like pressure, volume, temperature and mass are very important because relationship between these variables describes state of the gas. Interdependence of these variables leads to the formulation of gas laws. In the next section, we will learn about gas laws. 5.5 The gas laws. The gas laws which we will study now are the result of research carried on for several centuries on the physical properties of gases. The first reliable measurement on properties of gases was made by Anglo-Irish scientist Robert Boyle in 1662. The law which he formulated is known as Boyle's law. Later on, attempts to fly in air with the help of hot air balloons motivated Jacques Charles and Joseph Lévis Gay-Lussac to discover additional gas laws. Contribution from Avogadro and other provided lot of information about gaseous state. 5.5.1 Boyle's law, pressure-volume relationship. On the basis of his experiments, Robert Boyle reached to the conclusion that at constant temperature, the pressure of a fixed amount of gas varies inversely with its volume. This is known as Boyle's law. Mathematically, it can be written as pressure is inversely proportional to volume. And then next P is equals to K1 1 upon V, where K1 is proportionality constant. The value of constant K1 depends upon the amount of the gas, temperature of the gas and the units in which P and V are expressed. On rearranging equation 5.2, we obtain PV is equals to K1. It means that at constant temperature, product of pressure and volume of a fixed amount of gas is constant. If a fixed amount of gas at constant temperature P occupying volume V1 at pressure P1 undergoes expansion so that volume becomes V2 and pressure becomes P2, then according to Boyle's law, P1 V1 is equals to P2 V2 is equals to constant. P1 P1 upon P2 is equals to V2 upon V1. Figure 5.5 shows two conventional ways of graphically presenting Boyle's law. Figure 5.5a is the graph of equation 5.3 at different temperatures. The value of K1 for each curve is different because for a given mass of gas, it varies only with temperature. Each curve corresponds to a different constant temperature and is known as an isotherm. Higher curves correspond to higher temperature. It should be noted that volume of the gas doubles if pressure is halved. Table 5.1 gives effect of pressure and volume of 0.09 mole of CO2 at 300 Kelvin. Figure 5.5b represents the graph between P and 1 upon V. It is a straight line passing through origin. However, at high pressures, gases deviate from Boyle's law, and under such a condition, a straight line is not obtained in the graph. Experiments of Boyle in a quantitative manner prove that gases are highly compressible because when a given mass of a gas is compressed, the same number of molecules occupy a smaller space. This means that a gas has become denser at a high pressure. A relationship can be obtained between density and pressure of a gas by using Boyle's law. By definition, density D is related to the mass M and the volume V by the relation. D is equals to M by V. If we put value of V in this equation from Boyle's law equation, we obtain the relationship D is equals to M upon K1 into P is equals to K dash P. This shows that at constant temperature, pressure is directly proportional to the density of a fixed mass of the gas. 5.5.2 Charles' law, temperature-volume relationship. Charles and Galusik performed several experiments on gases independently to improve upon hot air balloon technology. Their investigation showed that for a fixed mass of a gas at constant pressure, volume of a gas increases on increasing temperature and decreases on cooling. They found that for each degree rise in temperature, volume of a gas increases by 1 upon 273.15 of the original volume of the gas at 0 degree Celsius. Thus, if volumes of the gas at 0 degree Celsius and at T degree Celsius are V0 and VT respectively, then Vt is equals to V0 plus T upon 273.15 V0. Vt is equals to V0 in bracket 1 plus T upon 273.15. Vt is equals to V0 in bracket 273.15 plus T upon 273.15. At this stage, we define a new scale of temperature such that T degree Celsius on new scale is given by capital T is equals to 273.15 plus T, and 0 degree Celsius will be given by T0 is equals to 273.15. This new temperature scale is called the Kelvin temperature scale or absolute temperature scale. The 0 degree Celsius on the Celsius scale is equal to 273.15 Kelvin at the absolute scale. Note that degree sign is not used while writing the temperature in absolute temperature scale, that is Kelvin scale. Kelvin scale of temperature is also called thermodynamic scale of temperature and is used in all scientific works. Thus, we add 273 to the Celsius temperature to obtain temperature at Kelvin scale. If we write capital T small t is equals to 273.15 plus T and T0 is equals to 273.15, in the equation 5.6, we obtain the relationship Vt is equals to V0 in bracket Tt upon T0. Vt upon V0 is equals to Tt upon T0. Thus, we can write a general equation as follows. V2 upon V1 is equals to T2 upon T1. V1 upon T1 is equals to V2 upon T2. V upon T is equals to constant is equals to K2. Thus, V is equals to K2 into T. The value of constant K2 is determined by the pressure of the gas, its amount and the units in which volume V is expressed. Equation 5.10 is the mathematical expression for Charles' law that states that pressure remaining constant, the volume of a fixed mass of a gas is directly proportional to its absolute temperature. Charles found that for all gases at any given pressure, graph of volume versus temperature is a straight line, and on extending to zero volume, each line intercept the temperature axis at -273.15 degrees Celsius. Slopes of lines obtained at different pressure are different, but at zero volume, all the lines meet the temperature axis at -273.15 degrees Celsius. Each line of the volume versus temperature graph is called isobar. Observations of Charles can be interpreted if we put the value of T in equation 5.6 as -273.15 degrees Celsius. We can see that the volume of the gas at -273.15 degrees Celsius will be zero. This means that gas will not exist. In fact, all the gases get liquefied before this temperature is reached. The lowest hypothetical or imaginary temperature at which gases are supposed to occupy zero volume is called absolute zero. All gases obey Charles' law at very low pressures and high temperatures. 5.5.3 Galusik's law, pressure-temperature relationship. Pressure in well-inflated tires of automobiles is almost constant, but on a hot summer day, this increases considerably and tire may burst if pressure is not adjusted properly. During winters on a cold morning, one may find the pressure in the tires of a vehicle decreases considerably. The mathematical relationship between pressure and temperature was given by Joseph Galusik and is known as Galusik's law. It states that at constant volume, pressure of a fixed amount of a gas varies directly with the temperature. Mathematically, pressure is directly vary with temperature. P upon T is equals to constant is equals to K3. This relationship can be derived from Boyle's law and Charles' law. Pressure versus temperature graph at constant molar volume is shown in figure 5.7. Each line of this graph is called isopore. 5.5.4 Avogadro law, volume amount relationship. In 1811, Italian scientist Amedeo Avogadro tried to combine conclusions of Dalton's atomic theory and Galusik's law of combining volumes, which is now known as Avogadro law. It states that equal volumes of all gases under the same conditions of temperature and pressure contain equal number of molecules. This means that as long as the temperature and pressure remain constant, the volume depends upon number of molecules of the gas, or in other words, amount of the gas. Mathematically, we can write volume is directly proportional to moles, where N is the number of moles of the gas, V is equals to K4 into N. The number of molecule in 1 mole of a gas has been determined to be 6.022 into 10 to 23 and is known as Avogadro constant. You will find that this is the same number which we came across while discussing definition of a mole in unit 1. Since volume of a gas is directly proportional to the number of moles, 1 mole of each gas at standard temperature and pressure will have same volume. Standard temperature and pressure means 273.15 Kelvin temperature and 1 bar pressure. This value is approximate freezing temperature of water and atmospheric pressure at sea level. At STP, molar volume of an ideal gas or a combination of ideal gases is 22.71098 liter per mole. Molar volume of some gases is given in table 5.2. Number of moles of a gas can be calculated as follows. N is equals to small m upon capital M, where small m is equals to mass of the gas under investigation and capital M is equals to molar mass. Thus, V is equals to K4 m upon capital M. Equation 5.13 can be rearranged as follows. Capital M is equals to K4 into small m upon V is equals to K4 into D. Here D is the density of the gas. We can conclude from equation 5.14 that the density of a gas is directly proportional to its molar mass. A gas that follows Boyle's law, Charles' law and Avogadro law strictly is called an ideal gas. Such a gas is hypothetical. It is assumed that intermolecular forces are not present between the molecules of an ideal gas. Real gases follow these laws only under certain specific conditions when forces of interaction are practically negligible. In all other situations, this deviates from ideal behavior. You will learn about the deviations later in this unit. 5.6 Ideal gas equation. The three laws which we have learned till now can be combined together in a single equation, which is known as ideal gas equation. At constant temperature and mole, V is proportional, inversely proportional with pressure, that is Boyle's law. At constant P and N, V directly proportional with temperature, that is Charles' law. At constant pressure and temperature, volume is directly proportional with its mole, that is Avogadro law. Thus, V is directly proportional with mole and temperature and inversely proportional with pressure. So V is equals to R and T upon P, where R is the proportionality constant. On rearranging the equation 5.16, we obtain PV is equals to nRT and R is equals to PV upon nT. R is called gas constant. It is the same for all the gases. Therefore, it is also called universal gas constant. Equation 5.17 is called the ideal gas equation. Equation 5.18 shows that the value of R depends upon unit in which P, V and T are measured. If three variables in this equation are known, fourth can be calculated. From this equation, we can see that at constant temperature and pressure, N moles of any gas will have the same volume because V is equals to nRT upon P and nRT and P are constant. This equation will be applicable to any gas under those conditions when behavior of the gas approaches ideal behavior. Volume of 1 mole of an ideal gas under STP condition is 22.710981 liter per mole. Value of R for 1 mole of an ideal gas can be calculated under this conditions as follows. R is equals to 10 to 5 Pascal into 22.71 into 10 to minus 3 meter cube upon 1 mole into 273.15 Kelvin is equals to 8.31 joule per Kelvin into mole. At STP conditions used earlier, value of R is 8.20578 into 10 to minus 20 liter atmosphere per Kelvin into mole. Ideal gas equation is a relationship between four variables and it describes the state of any gas. Therefore, it is also called equation of state. Let us now go back to the ideal gas equation. This is the relationship for the simultaneous variations of the variables. If temperature, volume and pressure of a fixed amount of gas vary from T1, V1 and P1 to T2, V2 and P2, then we can write P1, V1 upon T1 is equals to nR and P2, V2 upon T2 is equals to nR. So P1, V1 upon T1 is equals to P2, V2 upon T2. Equation 5.19 is a very useful equation. If out of 6 values of 5 variables are known, the value of unknown variable can be calculated from the equation 5.19. This equation is also known as combined gas law. 5.6.1 Density and molar mass of a gaseous substance. Ideal gas equation can be rearranged as follows. N upon V is equals to P upon RT. Replacing N by M upon capital M, we get small m upon capital M into V is equals to P upon RT. D upon M is equals to P upon RT. On rearranging equation 5.21, we get the relationship for calculating molar mass of a gas. Capital M is equals to DRT upon P. 5.6.2 Dalton's law of partial pressures. The law was formulated by John Dalton in 1801. It states that the total pressure exerted by the mixture of known reactive gases is equal to the sum of the partial pressures of individual gases. That is the pressures which these gases would exert if they were enclosed separately in the same volume and under the same conditions of temperature. In a mixture of gases, the pressure exerted by the individual gas is called partial pressure. Mathematically, P total is equals to P1, P2, P3 plus onwards, where P total is the total pressure exerted by the mixture of gases and P1, P2, P3, etc. are the partial pressure of gases. Gases are generally collected over water and therefore are moist. Pressure of dry gas can be calculated by subtracting vapor pressure of water from the total pressure of the moist gas, which contains water vapors also. Pressure exerted by saturated water vapor is called aqueous tension. Aqueous tension of water at different temperature is given in table 5.3. P dry gas is equals to P total minus aqueous tension. Partial pressure in terms of mole fraction. Suppose at the temperature T, three gases enclosed in the volume V exert partial pressure P1, P2 and P3 respectively. Then P1 is equals to N1 RT upon V, P2 is equals to N2RT upon V, and P3 is equals to N3RT upon V. Where N1, N2 and N3 are number of moles of this gases, thus expression for total pressure will be P total is equals to P1, P2, P3 is equals to N1RT upon V plus N2RT upon V plus N3RT upon V is equals to N1 plus N2 plus N3 into RT upon V. On dividing P1 by P total, we get P1 upon P total is equals to in bracket N1 upon N1 plus N2 plus N3 into RTV upon RTV is equals to N1 upon N1 plus N2 plus N3 is equals to N1 upon N is equals to X1, where N is equals to N1 plus N2 plus N3. X1 is called mole fraction of first gas. This P1 is equals to X1 into P total. Similarly, for the other two gases, we can write P2 is equals to X2 into P total and P3 is equals to X3 into P total. Thus, a general equation can be written as P1 is equals to X1 into P total, where P1 and X1 are partial pressure and mole fraction of ith gas respectively. And if total pressure of a mixture of gases is known, the equation 5.29 can be used to find out pressure exerted by individual gases. 5.7 Kinetic Molecular Theory of Gases. So far, we have learned the laws, which are concise statements of experimental fact observed in the laboratory by the scientist. Conducting careful experiments is an important aspect of scientific method, and it tells us how the particular system is behaving under different conditions. However, once the experimental facts are established, a scientist is curious to know why the system is behaving in that way. For example, gas law helps us to predict that pressure increases when we compress gases, but we would like to know what happens at a molecular level when a gas is compressed. A theory is constructed to answer such questions. A theory is a model that enables us to better understand our observations. The theory that attempts to elucidate the behavior of gases is known as kinetic molecular theory. Assumptions or postulates of the kinetic molecular theory of gases are given below. These postulates are related to atoms and molecules which cannot be seen, hence it is said to provide a microscopic model of gases. Gases consist of large number of identical particles that are so small and so far apart on the average that the actual volume of the molecule is negligible in comparison to the empty space between them. They are considered as point masses. This assumption explains the great compressibility of gases. Next, there is no force of attraction between the particles of a gas at ordinary temperature and pressure. The support for this assumption comes from the fact that gases expand and occupy all the space available to them. Next, particles of a gas are always in constant and random motion. If the particles were at rest and occupied fixed positions, then a gas would have had a fixed shape, which is not observed. Next, particles of a gas move in all possible directions in straight lines. During the random motion, they collide with each other and with the walls of the container. Pressure is exerted by the gas as the result of collision of the particles with the walls of the container. Next, collisions of gas molecules are perfectly elastic. This means the total energy of molecules before and after the collision remains same. There may be exchange of energy between colliding molecules. Their individual energies may change, but the sum of their energies remain constant. If there were loss of kinetic energy, the motion of molecules will stop and gases will settle down. This is contrary to what is actually observed. Next, at any particular time, different particles in the gas have different speeds and hence different kinetic energies. This assumption is reasonable because as the particle colloid, we expect the speed to change. Even if initial speed of all the particles was same, the molecular collisions will disrupt this uniformity. Consequently, the particles must have different speeds, which go on changing constantly. It is possible to show that though the individual speeds are changing, the distribution of speeds remain constant at a particular temperature. Next, If a molecule has variable speed, then it must have a variable kinetic energy. Under these circumstances, we can talk only about average kinetic energy. In kinetic theory, it is assumed that average kinetic energy of the gas molecule is directly proportional to the absolute temperature. It is seen that on heating a gas at constant volume, the pressure increases. On heating the gas, kinetic energy of the particle increases, and this strikes the walls of the container more frequently, thus exerting more pressure. Kinetic theory of gases allow us to derive theoretically all the gases laws studied in the previous sections. Calculations and predictions based on kinetic theory of gases agree very well with experimental observations and thus establish the correctness of this model. 5.8 Behavior of real gases, deviation from ideal gas behavior. Our theoretical model of gases correspond very well with experimental observation. Difficulty arises when we try to test how far the relation PV is equals to nRT reproduces actual pressure volume temperature relationship of gases. To test this point, we put PV versus P plot. Constant temperature PV will be constant, and PV versus P graph at all pressure will be a straight line parallel to x-axis. Figure 5.8 shows such a plot constructed from actual data for several gases at 273 Kelvin. It can be seen easily that at constant temperature, PV versus P plot for real gases is not a straight line. There is a significant deviation from ideal behavior. Two types of curves are seen. In the curves for dihydrogen and helium, at the pressure increases, the value of PV also increases. The second type of plot is seen in the case of other gases like carbon monoxide and methane. In these plots, first there is a negative deviation from ideal behavior. The PV value decreases with increase in pressure and reaches to a minimum value characteristics of a gas. After that, PV value starts increasing. The curve then crosses the line for ideal gas and after that shows positive deviation continuously. It is thus found that real gases do not follow ideal gas equation perfectly under all conditions. Deviation from ideal behavior also becomes apparent when pressure versus volume plot is drawn. The pressure versus volume plot of experimental data and the theoretically calculated from Boyle's law should coincide. Figure 5.9 shows this plot. It is apparent that at very high pressure, the measured volume is more than the calculated volume. At low pressures, measured and calculated volumes approach each other. It is found that real gases do not follow Boyle's law, Charles' law and Avogadro law perfectly under all conditions. Now two questions arises. First, why do gases deviate from the ideal behavior? And second, what are the conditions under which gases deviate from ideality? We get the answer to the first question if we look into postulates of kinetic energy once again. We find that two assumptions of the kinetic theory do not hold good. These are A. There is no force of attraction between the molecules of a gas, and B. Volume of molecules of a gas is negligibly small in comparison to the space occupied by the gas. If assumption A is correct, the gas will never liquefy. However, we know that gases do liquefy when cooled and compressed. Also, liquid forms are very difficult to compress. This means that forces of repulsion are powerful enough and prevent squashing of molecules in tiny volume. If assumption B is correct, the pressure versus volume graph of experimental data and that theoretically calculated from Boyle's law should coincide. Real gases show deviations from ideal gas law because molecules interact with each other. At high pressures, molecules of gases are very close to each other. Molecular interactions start operating. At high pressure, molecules do not strike the walls of the container with full impact because these are dragged back by other molecules due to molecular attractive forces. This affects the pressure exerted by the molecules on the walls of the container. Thus, the pressure exerted by the gas is lower than the pressure exerted by the ideal gas. P ideal is equals to P real plus A n square upon V square. Here A is a constant. Repulsive forces also become significant. Repulsive interactions are short-range interactions and are significant when molecules are almost in contact. This is the situation at high pressure. The repulsive forces cause the molecules to behave as small but impenetrable spheres. The volume occupied by the molecules also becomes significant because instead of moving in volume V, these are now restricted to volume where NB is approximately the total volume occupied by the molecules themselves. Here B is a constant. Having taken into account the correction for pressure and volume, we can rewrite equation 5.17 as in bracket P plus AN square upon V square bracket complete V minus NB is equals to nRT. Equation 5.31 is known as Van der Waals equation. In this equation, N is the number of moles of the gas. Constants A and B are called Van der Waals constants and their values depend on the characteristic of a gas. Value of A is measure of magnitude of intermolecular attractive forces within the gas and the independent of temperature and pressure. Also, at very low temperature, intermolecular forces become significant. As the molecules travel with low average speed, this can be captured by one another due to attractive forces. Real gases show ideal behavior when conditions of temperature and pressure are such that the intermolecular forces are practically negligible. The real gases show ideal behavior when pressure approaches zero. The deviation from ideal behavior can be measured in terms of compressibility factor Z, which is the ratio of product PV and nRT mathematically. nRT mathematically, Z is equals to PV upon nRT. For ideal gas, Z is equals to 1 at all temperature and pressures because PV is equals to nRT. The graph of Z versus P will be a straight line parallel to pressure axis. For gases which deviate from ideality, value of Z deviates from unity. At very low pressures, all gases shown have Z is equals to 1 and behave as ideal gas. At high pressure, all the gases have Z is greater than 1. These are more difficult to compress. At intermediate pressure, most gases have Z is less than 1. Thus, gases show ideal behavior when the volume occupied is large so that the volume of these molecules can be neglected in comparison to it. In other words, the behavior of the gas becomes more ideal when pressure is very low. Up to what pressure a gas will follow the ideal gas law depends upon the nature of the gas and its temperature. The temperature at which a real gas obeys ideal gas law over an appreciable range of pressure is called boil temperature or boil point. Boil point of a gas depends upon its nature. Above their boil point, real gases show positive deviations from ideality and Z values are greater than 1. The forces of attraction between the molecules are very feeble. Below boil temperature, real gases force show decrease in Z value with increasing pressure, which reaches a minimum value. On further increase in pressure, the values of Z increases continuously. Above explanation shows that at low pressure and high temperature, gases show ideal behavior. These conditions are different for different gases. More insight is obtained in the significance of Z if note the following derivation. Z is equals to PV real upon nRT. If the gas shows ideal behavior, then V ideal is equals to nRT upon P. On putting this value of nRT upon P in equation 5.33, we have Z is equals to V real upon V ideal. From equation 5.34, we can see that compressibility factor is the ratio of actual molar volume of a gas to the molar volume of it, if it were an ideal gas at the temperature and pressure. In the following sections, we will see that it is not possible to distinguish between gaseous state and liquid state, and that liquids may be considered as continuation of gas phase into a region of small volumes and very high molecular attraction. We will also see how we can use isotherms of gases for predicting the conditions for liquefaction of gases. 5.9 Liquefaction of gases. First, complete data on pressure, volume, temperature, relations of a substance in both gases, both gaseous and liquid state was obtained by Thomas Andrews on carbon dioxide. He plotted isotherms of carbon dioxide at various temperatures. Later on, it was found that real gases behave in the same manner as carbon dioxide. Andrews noticed that at high temperatures, isotherms look like that of an ideal gas and the gas cannot be liquefied even at very high pressure. As the temperature is lowered, shape of the curve changes and data shows considerable deviation from ideal behavior. At 30.98 degrees Celsius, carbon dioxide remains gas up to 73 atmospheric pressure. At 73 atmospheric pressure, liquid carbon dioxide appears for the first time. The temperature 30.98 degrees Celsius is called critical temperature TC of carbon dioxide. This is the highest temperature at which liquid carbon dioxide is observed. Above this temperature, it is gas. Volume of 1 mole of the gas at critical temperature is called critical volume, and pressure at this temperature is called critical pressure. The critical temperature, pressure and volume are called critical constants. Further increases in pressure simply compresses the liquid carbon dioxide, and the curve represents the compressibility of the liquid. The step line represents the isotherm of liquid. Even a slight compression results in steep rise in pressure, indicating very low compressibility of the liquid. Below 30.98 degrees Celsius, the behavior of the gas on compression is quite different. At 21.5 degrees Celsius, carbon dioxide remains as a gas only up to point B. At point B, liquid of a particular volume appears. Further compression does not change the pressure. Liquid and gaseous carbon dioxide coexist, and further application of pressure results in the condensation of more gas until the point C is reached. At point C, all the gas has been condensed, and further application of pressure merely compresses the liquid as shown by strip line. A slight compression from volume V2 to V3 results in step rise in pressure from P2 to P3. Below 30.98 degrees Celsius, that is critical temperature, each curve shows the similar trend. Only length of the horizontal line increases at lower temperatures. At critical point, horizontal portion of the isotherm merges into one point. Thus, we see that a point like A in the figure 5.11 represents gaseous state. A point like D represent liquid state, and a point under the dome-shaped area represent existence of liquid and gaseous carbon dioxide in equilibrium. All the gases upon compression at constant temperature show the same behavior as shown by carbon dioxide. Also, our discussion shows that gases should be cooled below their critical temperature for liquefaction. Critical temperature of a gas is highest temperature at which liquefaction of the gas first occurs. Liquefaction of so-called permanent gases requires cooling as well as considerable compression. Compression brings the molecules in close vicinity, and cooling slows down the movement of molecules. Therefore, intermolecular interactions may hold the closely and slowly moving molecules together, and the gas liquefies. It is possible to change a gas into liquid or a liquid into gas by a process in which always a single phase is present. For example, in figure 5.11, we can move from point A to F vertically by increasing the temperature. Then we can reach the point G by compressing the gas at the constant temperature along with this isotherm. The pressure will increase. Now we can move vertically down towards D by lowering the temperature. As soon as we cross the point H on the critical isotherm, we get liquid. We end up with liquid, but in this series of changes, we do not pass through two-phase region. If process is carried out at the critical temperature, substance always remains in one phase. Thus, there is continuity between the gases and liquid state. The term fluid is used for either a liquid or a gas to recognize this continuity. Thus, a liquid can be viewed as a very dense gas. Liquid and gas can be distinguished only when the fluid is below its critical temperature and its pressure and volume lie under the dome. Since in that situation, liquid and gas are in equilibrium and a surface separating the two phases is visible. In the absence of this surface, there is no fundamental way of distinguishing between two states. At critical temperature, liquid passes into gaseous state imperceptibly and continuously. The surface separating two phases disappears. A gas below the critical temperature can be liquefied by applying pressure and is called vapor of the substance. Carbon dioxide gas below its critical temperature is called carbon dioxide vapor. Critical constants for some common substances are given in table 5.4. 5.10 Liquid state. Intermolecular forces are stronger in liquid state than in gaseous state. Molecules in liquid are so close that there is very little empty space between them, and under normal conditions, liquid are denser than gases. Molecules of liquids are held together by attractive intermolecular forces. Liquids have definite volume because molecules do not separate from each other. However, molecules of liquids can move past one another freely. Therefore, liquids can flow, can be poured, and can assume the shape of the container in which these are stored. In the following sections, we will look into some of the physical properties of the liquids, such as vapor pressure, surface tension, and viscosity. 5.10.1 Vapor pressure. If an evacuated container is partially filled with a liquid, a portion of liquid evaporates to fill the remaining volume of the container with vapor. Initially, the liquid evaporates and pressure exerted by vapors on the walls of the container increases. After some time, it becomes constant and equilibrium is established between liquid phase and vapor phase. Vapor pressure at this stage is known as equilibrium vapor pressure or saturated vapor pressure. Since process of vaporization is temperature independent, the temperature must be mentioned by reporting the vapor pressure of a liquid. When a liquid is heated in an open vessel, the liquid vaporizes from the surface. At the temperature at which vapor pressure of the liquid becomes equal to the external pressure, vaporization can occur throughout the bulk of the liquid and vapor expand freely into the surroundings. The condition of free vaporization throughout the liquid is called boiling. The temperature at which vapor pressure of liquid is equal to the external pressure is called boiling temperature at that pressure. Vapor pressure of some common liquids at various temperature is given in figure 5.12. At 1 atmosphere pressure, boiling temperature is called normal boiling point. If pressure is 1 bar, then the boiling point is called standard boiling point of the liquid. Standard boiling point of the liquid is slightly lower than the normal boiling point because 1 bar pressure is slightly less than 1 atmosphere pressure. The normal boiling point of water is 100 degree Celsius. Its standard boiling point is 99.6 degree Celsius. At high altitudes, atmospheric pressure is low. Therefore, liquids at high altitude boil at lower temperatures in comparison to that at sea level. Since water boils at low temperature on heels, the pressure cooker is used for cooking food. In hospitals, surgical instruments are sterilized in autoclaves in which boiling point of water is increased by increasing the pressure above the atmospheric pressure by using a weight covering the vent. Boiling does not occur when liquid is heated in a closed vessel. On heating continuously, vapor pressure increases. At first, a clear boundary is visible between liquid and vapor phase because liquid is more dense than vapor. As the temperature increases, more and more molecules go to vapor phase and density of vapor rises. At the same time, liquid becomes less dense. It expands because molecules move apart when density of liquid and vapors become the same. The clear boundary between liquid and vapors disappears. This temperature is called critical temperature, about which we have already discussed in section 5.9. 5.10.2 Surface tension. It is a well known fact that liquids assume the shape of the container. Why is it then small drops of mercury form spherical bead instead of spreading on the surface? Why do particles of soil at the bottom of river remain separated but they stick together when taken out? Why does the liquid rise in a thin capillary as soon as the capillary touches the surface of the liquid? All these phenomena are caused due to the characteristic property of liquids called surface tension. A molecule in the bulk of liquid experiences equal intermolecular forces from all sides. The molecule therefore does not experience any net force. But for the molecule on the surface of liquid, net attractive forces towards the interior of the liquid due to the molecules below it, since there are no molecules above it. Liquids tend to minimize the surface area. The molecules on the surface experience a net downward force and have more energy than the molecules in the bulk, which do not experience any net force. Therefore, liquids tend to have minimum number of molecules at their surface. If surface of the liquid is increased by pulling a molecule from the bulk, attractive forces will have to be overcome. This will require expenditure of energy. The energy required to increase the surface area of the liquid by one unit is defined as surface energy. Its dimension are joule pressure. Surface tension is defined as the force acting per unit length perpendicular to the line drawn on the surface of liquid. It is denoted by Greek letter gamma. It has dimensions of kg upon s square and in SI unit is expressed as newton per meter. The lowest energy state of the liquid will be when surface area is minimum. Spherical shapes satisfy this condition, that is why mercury drops are spherical in shape. This is the reason that sharp glass edges are heated for making them smooth. On heating, the glass melt and the surface of the liquid tend to take the rounded shape and the edges at the edges, which makes the edges smooth. This is called fire polishing of glass. Liquid tend to rise in the capillary because of the surface tension. Liquid wet the things because they spread across the surface as thin film. moist soil grains are pulled together because surface area of thin film of water is reduced. It is surface tension which gives stretching property to the surface of a liquid. On flat surface, droplets are slightly flattened by the effect of gravity, but in the gravity-free environment, drops are perfectly spherical. The magnitude of surface tension of a liquid depends on the attractive forces between the molecules. When the attractive forces are large, the surface tension is large. Increase in temperature increases the kinetic energy of the molecules and effectiveness of intermolecular attraction decreases, so surface tension decreases as the temperature is raised. 5.10.3 Viscosity. It is one of the characteristic property of liquids. Viscosity is a measure of resistance to flow which arises due to the internal friction between layers of fluid as they slip past one another while liquid flows. Strong intermolecular forces between molecules hold them together and resist movement of layers past one another. When a liquid flows over a fixed surface, the layer of a molecule in the immediate contact of surface is stationary. The velocity of upper layers increases as the distance of layer from the fixed layer increases. This type of flow, in which there is a regular gradation of velocity in passing from one layer to the next, is called laminar flow. If we choose any layer in the flowing liquid, the layer above it accelerate its flow and the layer below this retard its flow. If the velocity of the layer at distance dz is changed by a value du, then velocity gradient is given by the amount du by dz. A force is required to maintain the flow of layers. This force is proportional to the area of contact of layers and velocity gradient. That is, F is directly proportional with A, and F is directly proportional with du and inversely proportional with dz. F is proportional with A into du by dz, and F is equals to eta A du by dz, where eta is a proportionality constant and it's called coefficient of viscosity. Viscosity coefficient is the force when velocity gradient is unity and the area of contact is unit area. Thus, coefficient of viscosity is measured of viscosity. SI unit of viscosity coefficient is 1 Newton second per square meter. In CGS system, the unit of coefficient of viscosity is Poiss, named after great scientist Jean-Louis Poiseuille. 1 Poiss is equals to 1 gram upon centimeter into S is equals to 10 raised to minus 1 kg upon meter into second. Greater the viscosity, the more slowly the liquid flows. Hydrogen bonding and van der Waals force are strong enough to cause high viscosity. Glass is an extremely viscous liquid. It is so viscous that many of its properties resemble solids. However, property of flow of glass can be experienced by measuring the thickness of window panes of old buildings. This become thicker at the bottom than at the top. Viscosity of liquids decreases as the temperature rises because at high temperature molecules have high kinetic energy and can overcome the intermolecular forces to slip past one another between the layers.